America is a gun culture. It always has been.
Today I am carrying a 9mm
AK-47.
Four different SIGs that I carry from time to time, so I like all four of them.
With an estimated 260 to 300 million guns in the national gun stock today, firearms aren't going anywhere.
The NRA has led the fight time and time again to protect our fundamental freedom.
And it would appear the political will to craft robust nationwide gun control legislation remains dead in the water. But with an epidemic of mass shootings,
tonight we remain a city in pain,
and gun accidents devastating communities nationwide, a small movement seeks to change the very technology at the heart of guns. Yet the players behind this movement to create a smarter gun are blocked at every turn.
Have you received any threats?
Oh yeah, of course.
And this is the story of why.
Nicholas was a wonderful boy. He was kind, he was funny, he was very cultural. What 12-year-old kid do you know that likes Tarkovsky movies? You know how you tell your children to be kind to others and befriend bullied kids, but you never know that they're doing it. Unfortunately, the way I found out he was is after he got killed, I received a lot of letters about it.
12-year-old Nicholas Nomkin was accidentally shot and killed by a friend in December 2010. Since that day, his mother, Oksana Nomkin, has become the driving force behind Nicholas's law, a bill requiring the safe storage of firearms in New York State.
We never owned guns and never hunted. And to me, it was always like a no-brainer, okay? Maybe even if you do, it's locked up, you know? Up until this happened to us, that was basically what we thought, and we never thought to ask. Who would think that you're sending your child to a play date and you have to find out there was a gun in the house?
Do you know what kind of gun was used?
It was a Ruger 9mm semi-automatic handgun.
Was it secured?
No, it wasn't. It was fully loaded and in just some sort of a sock drawer.
Oksana hopes Nicholas's law will put a dent in the approximately 33,000 people fatally shot in the United States every year. But there is a potential technological solution known as a smart gun. Proponents say it could prevent future tragedies like the Nomkins, and that it could even be more effective than a law when it comes to averting suicides and accidental killings. Yet the handgun as we know it remains a piece of mechanical technology that has skirted an era of rapid innovation, when almost everything else, from cars to phones to kitchen appliances, has been computerized. The question is, how come you can't find a smart gun anywhere?
It's a double action only. So what happens is when you draw the gun out, all you have to do is pull the trigger. There's no buttons, bells, or whistles on it.
Michael Timlin is the owner-operator of a gun store, shooting range, and gun training center. He swears by the time-tested simplicity of the modern firearm.
We want the gun to be about as easy as possible, so then when the gun is used, we don't have any issues with it. What's wrong with hundreds of years of gun ownership? It's not the epidemic that people like to believe. We're living in a perception.
Ladies and gentlemen, at this time, the range is going to go hot. Eyes and ears, please.
We are bombarded constantly with the negatives. We tune into the news every night, and what do we watch? Shoot, shot, kill, shoot, shoot, shoot. We don't see the good sides. Anybody that's anti-gun, they should feel very grateful that there are people who have guns out there. Because if you're standing in the mall, and a guy comes out and he starts to hurt people, and a civilian with a firearm shows up, then there's somebody there that will help you defend your life.
Do you sell any smart guns in this shop?
There is no such thing as a smart gun. We cannot put a device or anything on a firearm that would allow it to become smarter.
But there just might be a way. A smart gun is a user-authenticated firearm. That is, a gun that only fires in the hands of approved users, due to a biometric like a fingerprint reader or a magnetic or radio frequency identification proximity device like a ring or a bracelet. It's a technological innovation that has not gone unnoticed in the halls of the White House.
If we can set it up so you can't unlock your phone unless you got the right fingerprint, why can't we do the same thing for our guns?
But many pro-gun Americans, like Michael Timlin, aren't having it.
If there is a device of any kind that would be put onto a firearm in the defense of your life and it fails, then there is no use to have that device. It just will not work. So there's nothing that they can do with smart gun technology that would convince me that it would be good.
This sentiment is echoed by major gun lobbying groups like the National Rifle Association and the National Shooting Sports Foundation.
At some point, this technology is probably going to be pushed down our throats. Listen, let's be honest. The government at some point in time is going to try. That is a very frightening notion to a guy like myself or anybody who's a gun owner.
With that in mind, we're off to one of the biggest gun collections in the world that just so happens to belong to the U.S. government.
Hello.
M4, semi-automatic shotgun, shoots 12 gauge. All right, it is loaded.
We're in the gun range at the ATF's National Firearm Reference Vault.
We come in here to test firearms that we get in criminal cases for import evals or any kind of testing that we have to do here.
Whoa, perfect hit.
We're meeting with Earl Griffith, chief of the ATF Firearms and Ammunition Technology Division.
Handle that, see how it feels. It's a good conversation piece.
He walks us through the ATF's massive reference library.
Chuck Norris and others, you know, they have guns like this, and you know, these are actually a machine gun.
Which holds just about every type of gun there is.
Yeah, we have approximately 19,000 items in here. This gun is probably worth $40,000, $50,000. We have a lot of domestically made firearms, as well as guns from all around the world. That fits you very well, Brian.
Feels good.
Yeah.
Feels real good.
Maybe we'll get a chance to shoot some of those later.
Yeah, let's do it.
Why is the diversity of guns so mind-boggling, yet technologically, they've been pretty unchanging for a long time?
Well, I think the early designers got it right.
When you're in a room full of thousands of firearms, you realize just how little gun tech has evolved.
1911, this very design is still produced today.
Glocks, sawed-off shotguns, Tommy guns. The fundamental inner workings of these and just about every other gun are more or less the same. A user pulls a trigger that causes a mechanical firing pin to strike a primer. This creates an explosive chemical reaction that sends a projectile, be it a cannonball, a rocket, or a bullet, out of the gun's barrel, downrange.
That basic design is true for all firearms. And there you have it, yes. But
I didn't think it was gonna do that.
Yeah.
That's because firearms, since their inception, have been strictly mechanical devices, making them one of the few things unfazed by the electronics revolution.
A lot of those designs have not changed over the years, but yet they've been perfected with different materials and just a little bit of tweaking here and there. But most guns are very mechanical. There's not a lot of moving parts on them. So whenever you have less moving parts, they're gonna be probably more reliable.
This dedication to simplicity has meant firearm innovation tends to be cosmetic or defiantly low tech.
This is actually a firearm. Inside, you load it up and then you squeeze this part and it fires. This looks like a tire iron, but when you take it apart, you load it with a round of ammunition. It's called a slam fire. Pen guns, it actually will fire like a 22 round of ammunition.
And there's a will, there's a way.
If it rains, you know, you can put it up and you know, stay dry, but it also is a firearm. Yeah, so throughout the years, there's been a lot of different innovations, kind of like if you build it, someone will buy it.
No user-authenticated smart guns. I'm not seeing anything like that.
No, we have no smart guns in here. There's very few smart guns that have been produced and put on the market. And so it's going to take industry or independent people out there to want to perfect this technology to get it into our, as we know, traditional guns.
Everybody's always interested in safety, but you have to look at safety at what cost and at what price.
The path to market for smart guns has been a long one that's repeatedly hit a dead end.
If you were using it as a carry gun, you'd have to stop and go,
this gun must be unlocked through a code.
It's too slow.
In fact, a pair of pioneering American gun manufacturers coordinated with the U.S. government to design a smart gun, and it almost sunk both companies.
It is time for Congress to pull the trigger on legislation that will truly make guns safer.
In 1997, Colt, a firearms company that's been around since the Civil War and helped popularize the revolver, announced it was prototyping a user-authenticated smart gun.
This gun is now communicating with its transponder. The transponder is communicating back with the gun, and I can sear it off.
The news led to major blowback from Colt's loyal customer base, triggering a grassroots boycott. After months of criticism, Colt abruptly pulled the plug on the project in the attempt to recover the company's reputation. In 2001, gun manufacturer Smith & Wesson faced a number of municipal and federal lawsuits over gun violence.
Good afternoon.
So the company cut a deal with the Clinton administration.
Under the agreement, Smith & Wesson will include locking devices and other safety features, and will develop smart guns that can be fired only by the adults who own them.
Like Colt, Smith & Wesson faced tremendous opposition. An ensuing boycott turned the company into a gun industry pariah. Smith & Wesson faced a multi-million dollar drop in value that year and was forced to lay off 15% of its workforce before an eventual sale. Needless to say, Smith & Wesson's smart gun didn't make it out of the lab either. Meanwhile, back in the ATF vault, we see cannons, RPGs, World War II-era machine guns, AKs, ARs, Glocks, 3D-printed Liberators, 1911s, this thing.
So called a street sweeper.
All manner of low-tech lethal innovations, even a goddamn briefcase gun.
So you're carrying it along and it shoots out here and then you, you know.
And yet, no smart guns.
Yeah. So if you build it, you know, they'll buy it type thing. You know, a smart gun. Some critics out there would say that we have the technology and would work. I'll tell you that we don't think the technology is there yet.
So as of right now, this is what state of the art looks like.
Full auto, here we go.
A finely tuned AR platform like this HK416 represents the pinnacle of traditional gun innovation. But that doesn't mean there aren't people out there working to disrupt this largely static order. Take the guy who designed the very gun I just shot.
Let's have a toast.
Hey,
to cheers. This. Hallelujah. Cheers. I wish it everybody.
Ernst Mauch is a gun legend, known throughout the industry for his work with renowned German arms manufacturer Heckler & Koch, or H&K.
To do what you say and to stand for what you do. It's not so easy. That's the reason why I have such a broad back.
The HK416 assault rifle is what Mauch is perhaps best known for. It's a standard armament for U.S. Special Forces and has gained worldwide popularity as the gun that allegedly killed Osama bin Laden. How do you feel when people call you sort of a rock star of the gun industry?
I never feel as a rock star and as a legend. I am a normal man who did his job during his life.
Mauch is in D.C. looking for partners to help with his decades-long quest to build and popularize the perfect smart gun. What inspired you to start looking at smart gun technology?
An accident in the United States where a 6-year-old young boy killed his friend, also a 6-year-old boy, with a gun from H&K.
It's a story that hits close to home in households across America.
What can you tell me about smart guns?
Smart guns would be a logical choice for a family if they choose to have a weapon for protection this wouldn't prevent you from protecting your family, but it would prevent accidental deaths of children who are very curious. They're going to find this thing no matter what.
A lot of people would like to buy such kind of a gun to protect their homes. And I see a big potential here.
As a society, what do we stand to lose by not implementing intelligent gun technology?
Thousands and thousands more of lives of people, of children, and the idea and the technology is available.
Mao Khalef H&K in 2005 to join Armatics, where he led development on its signature smart gun, the IP-1.
The gun is implanted with an electronic chip that allows it to be fired only if the shooter is wearing a companion watch into which a PIN number has been entered.
The Armatics IP-1 was Mauch's baby and the first ever smart gun brought to market.
But if the watch is taken further than 10 inches away from the gun, a red light will come on and the weapon won't fire.
But when it launched, the response was less than positive.
We never sold an Armatex pistol. We have no inventory.
And when the IP-1 was first sold in the U.S., the reaction was even more severe.
So anyway, obviously I received numerous death threats today. I really appreciate that. That's f***ing classy.
Mauch left Armatics in 2015 over what he cites as a difference of opinion with the company's CEO. But he's still working toward a smart gun future.
The time is now right. People should start to support the idea. It will take time. And I will not give up. If it's not this country, I try to find them other partners to make it happen, yeah.
Despite his optimistic drive, Mauch is a veteran in the twilight of his career. If the smart gun is going to move forward, it needs fresh blood to see it through.
Every smart gun that we've seen so far has been pretty bad. So this is our most recent prototype of the BioFire smart gun. In this case, this is actually a modified Glock, but when we get to the point of actually manufacturing these, we'll be creating our own custom firearms.
Kai Klepfer has been working on a smart gun prototype since he was 15 years old. Today, he runs BioFire Technologies, a smart gun startup, from his MIT dorm room.
A lot of people definitely know at this point, but you know, which is awesome. Like I'm proud of what I'm working on. I think it's, you know, it's a worthwhile sort of pursuit, obviously. But it's also not the sort of thing that I like bringing up the first time I meet somebody.
As Kai develops his smart gun prototype, he keeps up on public perception and the competition.
The IP-1, in my opinion, was not a smart gun.
So why not?
The concept in and of itself, it just didn't make any sense. The gun is a 22 caliber, which is like a Boy Scout round. It's not a round that anybody ever has used for self-defense. There were a lot of design decisions behind it that just didn't seem to take into account the needs of gun owners. As simple as the colors on the back of the grip. It was a very standard green is unlocked and red is locked. The only issue is that means the exact opposite in the gun world. If you look at any firearm that's built in the last 100 years that has a safety on it, when the red dot is showing, that means hot, unsafe, ready to fire. You know, they have a wristband, but you have to type a PIN code into the wristband, and you have to keep both the watch and the gun charged. It's not a usable gun. It doesn't work to serve the purposes that people need to use their firearms for. And so, honestly, from the very, very beginning, I've made it clear that I'm trying to work with gun owners.
What was the impetus behind wanting to start doing this sort of research?
I got started with smart guns during my sophomore year of high school, when I was 15. I was looking for an engineering science fair project that maybe had a little bit more like societal impact. And so this was also about 2 months after the Aurora theater shooting. And I'm from Boulder, Colorado, which is about a half an hour away from Aurora. And so I actually started out not with how do I build a smart gun, but how can I address this problem of mass shootings? And as I started to do research around mass shootings, I realized that we have a mass shooting every single day in the United States. It just doesn't all happen in one place. And so we don't really hear about these single gun accidents and gun deaths, but they cause just as much damage as any mass shooting would. After I started doing some of that research, I switched from working on mass shootings to working on accidental gun deaths and suicides. Not only do I think they're a bigger problem, but they're one that lends itself much more readily to sort of an engineering solution.
Though Kai can't have his prototype on campus, he has many parts that compose the internal workings of the smart gun.
This is basically one of our current circuit boards, the brains of the operation in a lot of ways. These are a few of our fingerprint sensors. And when the user picks the handgun up, their finger naturally lands on the sensor, and that's how we start off the process of recognizing the user's fingerprint, basically. And these are a few of the batteries that we're using. You know, they're pretty small and thin.
Overall, it's not anywhere near as complicated as it looks. So we've got the fingerprint sensor and the circuit board and everything on this side. You know, the battery is along the other side. A traditional firearm of this style has what's known as a double stack magazine. We sort of switched that to a single stack magazine. So that reduces the number of rounds, but allows us to fit sort of all of the, you know, electronics and everything. When you sort of naturally grip the handgun, your middle finger is going to land right on that sensor. There's no like swiping or, you know, pushing buttons or any additional movement that's required on the part of the user. They just pick it up and it works. Yeah. I honestly expect, whether it's us or somebody else, to see smart guns pretty prevalent in the next 5 or 10 years. And honestly, further out from that 10, 20 years, if we still have guns, which hopefully we do, I think they're all going to be smart guns.
But it's this sort of techno-optimism that makes pro-gun Americans like Michael Timlin very nervous.
Do you think there is still some sort of consumer demand across the country for this technology?
Is there consumer demand for it? No. Actually, if you were talking to any true gun owner, there would be no demand for it at all. Matter of fact, it would be the opposite. This is not something we want.
So you'd never sell a smart gun?
I wouldn't allow a smart gun within a 100-mile radius of this facility, ever.
But one was on its way, courtesy of Jonathan Mossberg, owner of iGun Technologies. Mossberg happens to be in town for an informal summit of smart gun developers, so we ask him to swing by Mike's shop. He's bringing along the iGun, a personalized shotgun that only fires when the user wears a special magnetic tag in the form of a ring.
I think this technology has a significant use in certain specific situations, and I'd like to see it to go to that next level where people who choose to buy it, not are forced to buy it.
Kai's attending the same conference, so we invite him along as well.
Michael, this is Jonathan.
Michael, Jonathan, nice to meet you.
Good
to meet you.
Kai. This is Kai. Nice to meet you.
Do you think both of your respective technologies could someday be brought to market and appear in shops like Michael's here?
Definitely. You know, there are people who want to have a firearm in their house but are afraid to, you know, rightfully, because of the possibility of their children getting hold of it, even when it's properly secured and, you know, it's that one time they forget. If there's people willing to buy it, that means there's people who are willing to sell it.
I'm just waiting for the consumers to start demanding it. And when they're comfortable with it, when they know about it, when they test it, when they know it's reliable, distributors will be carrying it, manufacturers will be making it, and it'll be an option, only an option. And if they want to buy it, great. If they don't, that's fine too.
I do believe that you guys are onto something, but we start with good intentions and we wind up walking into gun bans. And new technology always leads into gun bans. You take a technology and the government gets their hands on it, or somebody gets their hands on it and say, hey, listen, we're using it for good, and then it becomes a mandatory type situation.
I am dead set against mandates. I want government, Kai does too, to keep government, to keep their paws out of this stuff. If New York makes this mandated, I will stamp on the side of my box, not for sale in the socialist state of New York.
If it didn't work, who's got the liability? With this technology, I could sit here right now and give you 1,000 what ifs. Your fingerprint technology, well, it doesn't work without a finger, and that happens.
Yep.
And your ring technology doesn't work without that ring. I look at your shotgun without that ring. For me, it's a stick. The technology needs for me to be more foolproof. That's really the direction I'm going.
But you will sell them a 1940s vintage Arisaka, literally 30% failure rate when I pull the trigger on some of those things. So we can't say that we're only going to sell them 100% reliable stuff. Yet I want my technology to be 1,000 times better than that. And I think Kai does too, and that's what we're achieving. We're trying to achieve that.
Maybe one day, hopefully in the future, there will be a perfect world for all of this.
We all head down to the range to try the iGun for ourselves.
Okay, we designed it to be seamless. In other words, you don't want to think in a stressful situation. You don't want to have to do something different than you're already trained to do. Pick it up and shoot it. If somebody takes it away from you, it doesn't work. Round of the chamber, closed. Now,
fires.
Can I give it a try?
Sure. Okay, so grab it with two hands, finger off the trigger, yep. Slide the forearm forward. That's it. So go ahead, put it up to your shoulder. Mm-hmm. Pull the trigger.
Nope.
Nothing happens.
Nothing.
Okay, so I'll give you the ring. Put it on.
Mm-hmm.
Slide the forearm forward.
Mm-hmm.
There you go.
Yep.
Hear that soft click right there?
Heard it, yeah.
Okay, we're red fire. Pump it back.
All right. Smart guns.
Well, I don't call it that, but it's...
What do you call it?
It's an eye gun, but there's multiple technologies out there, and we want to make sure that we don't all get lumped in together.
I'll give you your ring back.
Thanks.
Despite the demonstration, Michael remains unconvinced.
I have 2 children, 2 years old and 5 years old. I can guarantee you they will never shoot anyone with my gun, because I'm a responsible parent. If you take a gun and you leave it on the coffee table and you have a toddler running around, they're gonna get it. If you take poison and you leave it on the table, your toddler's gonna eat it. Should we ban everything on earth because a parent is too dumb to protect themselves from giving a child a gun? So here comes the smart gun people trying to fix that problem. Fix what? Fix stupidity? We can't fix stupid. I say this all the time to a lot of people who listen to me. Stupid is something that we cannot fix. Smart gun or not, educate people. You want to do something? You want to do some sort of eye gun type thing? Make an app where it educates people. Press a button. This is what happens with guns. This is what happens with this. This is how it works. Educate yourself. A smart gun technology is nowhere near the answer for this. What's been wrong with the way it's been?
This was his last school picture. Right before he was killed, this is September of 2010. This is the last picture we have of him. I always want to remember him this way. Happy child, good friend. It was the last day of school, December 22nd. He was called by a friend of his and was invited over for a play date. Around, I guess, 6, he called me and he says, "Mom, can I stay over?" So I said, "All right." He just started taking antibiotics. He had like a slight ear infection going. So my husband said, "Why don't I drive it over to him?" So when my husband got there was a bunch of police around the house. And they told him that Nicholas was shot. And so he called me at home and he said, "I don't know how to tell you this, honey, but he was shot." I said, "Shot? How, when, where, you know?" Later we found out that they were left alone in the house at some point. And his friend went and took his father's gun and he shot him. And then when we got to the Albany Medical Center, a neurologist came out and pretty much told us that there's no hope for him, that he has no brain activity. And they told us whenever we're ready, we could go in. So we went in about 2 o'clock in the morning and they disconnected him. And then his heart was beating for another 29 minutes. I had my head on his chest and it was like a torture. Knowing that every single time this could be the last heartbeat I ever hear. And then finally it stopped. And my sunshine was gone.
In the United States, 98 children aged 17 and younger were accidentally killed by firearms in 2010. Nicholas Nomkin was one of them. At the Harvard School of Public Health, researchers take a data-driven approach to studying gun violence.
Do you think that innovating guns would be a way of potentially cutting down on gun violence?
Yeah, I think absolutely. I think changing technology typically is the way to reduce injury and violence.
David Hemenway is the director of the Harvard Injury Control Research Center and the author of Private Guns, Public Health.
If we had smart guns, that would reduce gun theft, it would reduce gun accidents, it would reduce gun suicide, so certainly among teenagers.
If you could sit down with a staunch gun enthusiast that doesn't want anything to do with chips and a grip, what would you say to that person as a public health specialist? Yeah.
There's always people sort of fighting against improvements. So it took over 20 years fighting against the automobile industry to get airbags into cars, which have saved innumerable lives.
Is it as much about changing technology as it is about changing human behavior?
Typically, it's much more cost-effective to change the product than to try to educate every person. And people make mistakes all the time and often behave badly. In virtually all the successes in public health, it's really been changing the product and the environment, which has been shown to be the most effective.
It looks just like the ones on TV.
And in my video game.
Stop! Don't touch. Run away. Tell a grown-up.
The NRA believes in and advocates for personal responsibility and education. Its mascot, Eddie Eagle, is meant to teach kids about the importance of gun safety.
Whether here, there, or on a dare, fly away fast, don't have a scare.
Stop, don't touch, tell a grown-up, promoted, Eddie Eagle and the like. It doesn't work. There's lots of empirical evidence that it doesn't work.
Deborah Azrael is the associate director of the Harvard Youth Violence Prevention Center. Her research focuses on the relationship between gun access and gun death.
In these sort of rare events when we've been able to talk to pairs of parents and kids, the parent thinks that the kid doesn't know that there's a gun, and the parent thinks that the kid doesn't know where the gun is, and you talk to the kid with the parent out of the room, and the kid does know where the gun is, and the kid has used, has played with a gun. I mean, I understand that there's some cognitive dissonance there, but your kid knows where the Christmas presents are, your kid knows where the gun is.
Firearms haven't really changed that much. If anything, they've just gotten more and more powerful. Why do you think that is?
Both the NRA and the National Shooting Sports Foundation seem to have a stake in curtailing the development of smart guns. They say that they don't, and that what they object to is a mandate. To me, the most plausible reason for them to object to that technology is that if you sort of acknowledge that a gun can be made safer, the implication is that guns that don't incorporate smart technology are less safe, and that it's an effort to not open up what might be a Pandora's box of potential liability.
With a legacy of fierce opposition, it's surprising anyone would choose to develop a smart gun. That's part of what makes our final stop on this journey so interesting.
We're outside of Seattle, Washington, on our way to meet a renowned biohacker who's created something that's truly one of a kind.
Biohacking really is, in my opinion, the future of human evolution.
Emil Grofstra is not your typical gun guy.
So there's some groups out there that kind of think that RFID is evil. They really think that it's the mark of the beast, and it's, it's some kind of subscription to Satan himself. So I can tell you that no, it's not the case, at least for me.
He's been a prominent figure in the body implant scene since the mid-2000s. Today, he runs a custom bioware company called Dangerous Things out of his own garage.
My belief is that a really well-designed technology that's implanted, it has no management, it just kind of disappears.
When Motherboard met with Emil previously, he showed us some of his work.
I just wanted the door to recognize that it was me. This is a full Java card cryptographic platform. It's all contactless.
But something that was still in development on our prior visit has brought us back. The world's first biohacked smart gun, which Emil says is now ready for a test fire.
This is your garage here?
Yeah, office, garage, you know, lab space, door lock, implant. Yeah, there we go.
All right. There's the gun.
Are you a gun person?
I wouldn't say I'm a gun person, but there was a gun that I wanted to get, and I actually learned about it through video games. I thought, you know, if I'm going to get one, I want it to be something that one of my kids can't just pick up and shoot. You know, there's other smart guns that are being developed that are kind of based on, like, fingerprint or other things, and I just thought that, you know, those technologies are typically a little clunky or require, like, a wristband or some kind of wearable. I already had implants, so it just made sense to use a gun that worked with implants. So I'm like, I can make one. So this is a version of the tag that's basically glued to a stick. So that's what's inside the hand right there, little cylinder. And you can see I can kind of pop it up there. Mm-hmm. You can see it's the edge of it is trying to poke out there.
Can't feel it.
Yeah. And you can poke it and move it around a bit.
When did you put this in?
So this one went in March 2005, so over 11 years ago. It's MRI compliant as well. I can get an MRI or any medical procedure, it's fine. Go through security at the airport just fine.
Can the implants that you use with your smart gun be used to track the owner?
No, not at all. They're passive devices, which means there's no battery. They only operate when they're within the magnetic field of a reader, which means, you know, maybe an inch at most. That's the beauty of these devices. They're simple. No battery, no charging, no management. They just work. They're going to work and do their jobs beautifully every time, all the time. An implant system is just ideal because it's always there. You never forget it. You kind of forget about it, actually. It's really something that doesn't really interfere with your life until you need to use it. And in a scenario where you want to ensure that you're the only one operating the weapon, or you and your spouse, or you and other authorized users, it's kind of hard to beat a weapon that fundamentally, internally, won't function until you present an authorized ID.
Could you walk me through what goes into this gun and how it works?
There is a small area here where there's electronics, and then this grip area has an antenna coil around it, and then inside the trigger mechanism here, there's a little peg that will lock, and that blocks the trigger from being pulled. So in order to remove that additional lock, I have to present the implant to this reader in the grip area here. So when I do that, I can just do this. You hear it beep, you hear the little servo mechanism, and now I can operate the trigger.
Have you received any criticism or threats as a result of your work?
Oh yeah, of course. When I first got the implant in 2005, there was a lot of hubbub, and I received some death threats and things at that time. But then again, with the smart gun project, the death threats kind of resurfaced, and people saying that I was trying to, you know, work with the government or something to take away their American rights and all this stuff. And so this is the kind of thing that really got me thinking, like, a person that is actively advocating violence against another person for something they're doing in their garage who has not, doesn't really affect them and actually could help a lot of people is wanting to go murder me with their weapon, right? Like, this is the exact person that shouldn't have guns. And this is the heart of the argument about regulating. All I want to do is make a smart gun so my kid couldn't shoot themselves or me.
It's time to test fire Emil's creation. So we roll out to a local gun range.
I fired this gun once with the regular stock, and I'll be doing it for the first time with the electronics.
You feeling good about it?
I'm feeling pretty confident, yeah.
The initial test fire of the world's first biohacked smart gun is a success. But Emil soon runs into an unforeseen problem.
It may have locked. Yeah, it locked.
Locked?
So I think the shock from the firing is actually resetting it. So I'll fire, and it actually relocks the trigger.
But it's
works.
Working.
Yeah, it works, but it needs adjustment, obviously.
Got it, so. Emil plans to update the prototype until it suits his standards of reliability. But he holds no illusions about scaling up the tech for a wider market.
I'm happy with my product, for my personal use, but if people really want smart guns for these scenarios, they're going to have to get loud. They're going to have to be aggressive about wanting it. And this isn't to say contact your senator or anything. This is just to say contact gun makers. Like, contact people actually building guns and say, we want this technology. That's really how it's going to work, is driving market forces rather than regulatory forces.
What would you say to someone who thinks guns are just fine the way they are, so why should we try and innovate them?
Well, they've never had their child shot by accident, and they have no ability to step into anybody else's shoes or really imagine a scenario where somebody who is not fit to operate a weapon has one. To say there's no room for improvement, that's just ignorance and stubbornness, really. And, it's oftentimes, it takes serious tragedy for them to open their eyes a bit and say, oh, maybe a little bit of innovation and change could be a good thing in certain circumstances.
Here we are. This technology exists, and people are working on it, and people are trying to help. And not to get on board with that, I don't get.
If you could sit down with someone who owns a gun, but who opposes user-authenticated technology, what would you say to them?
I would say that it could definitely save somebody's life in your house. Because everybody is responsible until all of a sudden, oops, and then this happens. Then all of a sudden, you're not responsible anymore. And it happens in an instant, and it's just like, that's why smart guns are so important, I think, because it would definitely save my son's life. We will get there, but at the tremendous, tremendous cost of many, many, many people getting hurt or getting killed, and unfortunately, a lot more parents like living with what I live with every single day, which is not easy. I'm doing it, but it's not easy. It never leaves. You just kind of learn how to live with it. And you go on. But it's a new type of existence. The guilt is overwhelming too. Why am I here and he's not? Monsieur.